everyone, it was a Herculean task to bring back stranded Indians abroad. And in the last few months, 15 lakh Indians have been repatriated from various countries, and the blueprint has been prepared by the minister himself. The metros have started functioning as well with safety protocols. But the big question is, with the spike in cases, will there be shutdown as well? Joining me now to answer all those questions is Civil Aviation and Urban Development Minister, Mr. Hardeep Puri. Thank you so much for agreeing for this interview, sir. Mr. Puri, let's begin with the domestic scenario. It's been over 3.5 months since the domestic flights resumed. To be specific, May 25th, you have said that 8 million Indians have traveled so far. But because of the spike that we are seeing in positive cases, in fact, it will be nearing 1 lakh cases every day. Are you looking at opening more sectors or at the same time shutting down some?
First of all, thank you very much, Maria, for having me on your show. In order to understand or fully comprehend the imperatives of opening up, I think it would be better for me to try and share with you my understanding of the numbers. It's very easy for people to talk about spike, hike in number of people who are testing positive. But let's look at the overall picture, both in India and global. To begin with, we're a very large country. Okay. That large population, now a very large number of people are being tested. If you are testing millions of people and your positive rate is only 8%, your recovery rate is 80%, and your case mortality ratio is about 1.5%, then my submission to you is you don't have a cause to worry. Much of this information, like information on GDP numbers, much of the information on what are the scenarios, and many of my friends, personal friends, who are members of the distinguished fourth estate, sometimes end up painting alarmist scenarios. This is going to happen, that is going to happen. Look, the fact of the matter is, of all the viruses that we have dealt with, SARS was the one which had the highest mortality rate, 17%. H1N1, Ebola, and now COVID-19. COVID-19, the current Indian average, if you make allowance for variations in places, etc., and age groups, the average mortality rate is only 1.7%, so, which is twice that of normal influenza.
So in that case, you're only looking at opening up sectors?
No, I am not. I am not. You cannot just look at opening up. First of all, the decision to open up was in and of itself a very difficult one. Clamping down, having a lockdown is very easy because you are seeing the numbers rise everywhere in the world, and you want to lock down in order to insulate your population from what's happening globally. We were one of the first countries in the world which stopped flights from China. We were one of the first countries to introduce thermal screening at airports, at international airports. But there comes a time, and because the Prime Minister's lockdown was effective, we were able to buy time in order to produce the infrastructure required. The beds, the PPE kits manufacture, making ventilators. But there comes a time when the lockdown becomes as costly. You know, it's a decision between life and livelihood.
Okay.
Now, what we made a careful determination at the highest levels of the government and said, now if you have the systems in place, you can begin to open up. When we opened up domestic aviation on the 25th of May, you reminded me, there were 423 flights and we flew 30,000 passengers that day. Today, I just got the figure before I met you. Yesterday, there were 1,300 flights. Day before, and a few days ago, the maximum we reached was 141,000. Now, it is possible, because of the safety protocols in place, for us to open up and to be able to do it by observing all the safety precautions. That is my point.
You know, Mr. Puri, you said that media is sounding alarmist. I'm telling you what the International Air Transport Association has said. They themselves are saying that the global passenger traffic will not return to pre-COVID era till 2024. Are you of the same opinion?
It's a simple issue. Domestic civil aviation at the rate at which we are opening up today. Once all our states decide to allow the number of flights, it has been demonstrated that air travel is perhaps the safest mode of transport if you compare it to surface transport, bus, railways, etc. Everyone has a designated seat. The air ventilation is from top down. The nozzle comes down, gets filtered, clean. And the same is the case with the metro. So I am going to make a prediction to you on your show. And let's have a conversation later. Today, we are at a point where we are reaching about 140,000 passengers per day. Okay. We will reach the 150,000 passengers day very soon. And by the time we are in Diwali, we would be even higher. By 31st December of 2020, I am more than confident that our pre-COVID figure of 300,000 passengers a day would be reached. So not 2024,
by
31st December.
That's sounding very, very optimistic. What about the RT-PCR testing? We are seeing live RT-PCR testing take place in Delhi and Mumbai airports. Will you be expanding it to other airports?
Look, it's quite simple. RT-PCR tests are required. They were initially, let's see, what was happening is our airports were being clogged. When we opened the Vande Bharat flights, you mentioned a figure of 15 lakh. There were a lot of people, the state quarantine people, the state health, the what you call the triage at the airport. So we introduced RT-PCR tests. Just now, passengers coming in on Vande Bharat flights, okay, if they have been tested and they have been able to upload their negative report, they can just go through the green channel. My anxiety is, just now only about 30-40% people are availing of that. Many others are still queuing. You know, it's a human trait. Whenever you say that you need mandatory quarantine, you also have some exemption categories. What are the exemption categories? If you had a bereavement in your family. So what was happening at Delhi Airport, everybody was having, who wanted to avoid quarantine, was getting, negotiating through WhatsApp messages, ki bereavement hogi, jana, etc. That introduces an element of subjective discretion. So there's a lot of this going on, alarmist stuff going.
Can I
just complete this? So we decided to do away with subjective element altogether. You get yourself tested before you come. Within 96 hours, if you've had a test and you load it, you're negative, walk through the green channel. Now that is not enough. So we need to do prachar. We need to tell people there is a safer, quicker way out of the airport. Then we've done one step further. We have decided now, Maria, to install these machines at our airports here itself. So if, say, for instance, you forgot to take the test, or there's another problem, you can be tested here also. Create a separate area, including in Delhi Airport, where you can sit down, talk to people who will conduct the test, and you'll be... So we need to ensure that when civil aviation really opens up, you know, today we are at 150,000, will be soon. When we are back to pre-COVID levels, there's no congestion at the airports.
Let's talk about the refund of tickets, because that is one issue which is now generating a lot of consumer interest.
It was.
Yes. Sir, the center had told the Supreme Court that the full refund would be made. Do you think this was an avoidable controversy if you had in fact instructed the airlines well before time?
First of all, well before time means what? Before COVID outbreak, we had a situation where people could book what are called apex fares. You could book a seat 60 days in advance. You could book a seat 6 months in advance. One of my people who's part of our domestic staff booked this ticket to go to Patna 6 months in advance because you get very low fares. Now, we are not dealing with that situation. So put that aside. We gave a clear directive, the DGCA did, that if you booked during the COVID period when you were not supposed to, when flights were closed, you have to refund forthwith, immediately. There's no issue. Now what happened is some bookings after they opened up. We are very clear. Airlines, if they have collected money, they have to repay. But you have to look at the circumstances. So we have given a very detailed affidavit at the direction of the court. My own sense is that this problem was particularly acute during one period of time when airlines collected money, some of them, and they had no revenue stream. So they were not able to pay. Our instruction is very clear.
Okay.
Pay up.
Then what about the consumer bodies which are saying that there should be a refund of particularly those citizens who are senior citizens, and also regarding the airfare hike? Is there a sense that the ministry could take a relook particularly and go back?
Well, there's no airfare hike.
March 31st, pre-March 31st.
We are very clear. We've had stakeholder consultation. These stakeholder consultations have involved everyone. The airlines, it's a court-directed process, by the way. All the other stakeholders, including consumer association. But you have to be careful about what we are saying. Many of the fares for the tickets are not collected by the airlines. They're collected by travel agents. Now, the travel agents and the airlines have their own thing. Look, whenever a particular issue is causing consternation, I get to know pretty fast because I get trolled in the process. Now I'm finding out this is a problem which, as airlines have earnings, they will pay. The issue was a credit shell. You know, somebody said, well, look, if you have this overall impression that air traffic is not going to resume, then a credit shell doesn't make any sting. Now we made many innovative provisions. Like, for instance, if you booked a ticket and it's in the credit shell and you're not likely to travel, this is what somebody, you can pass that credit on to your sister or somebody in your family or a friend. Secondly, we are also put in a system of incentives and disincentives so that people don't use that route. So my sense is that that problem has either been resolved or is very soon going to be resolved at the next court hearing.
So when do you see the entire international air travel space, particularly be it Indians traveling abroad or those who are visiting India, resume like what you give me? You give me a specific deadline that you're hopeful by 31st of December things would be normal as far as aviation sector.
Substantially normal, yeah.
Substantially normal. What about the travel of Indians abroad?
Well, I can recall what I've been saying off and on. You cannot predict the or anticipate the behavior of the virus. That's a starting point. Second thing, international civil aviation, the way we've known it prior to COVID, which means every airline announces a summer schedule or a winter schedule, and any potential customer will just, you know, decide if he or she has a visa. Now, there are three things here which are not happening. First of all, the restrictions at the point of entry. Now, even if you have a valid US visa, I'm taking one example, and you're a student, well, unless the university is conducting physical classes, your visa is not going to be acted upon. You know, you'll be advised. Secondly, many countries, like in the Gulf, for instance, we are flying planes to certain countries, I would prefer not to name them, where we are flying the planes empty from here to those countries and bringing Indian passengers who are stranded back. Why? Because they are not allowing entry of either citizens other than their own, or they're not allowing citizens from some countries to enter. Second issue, if you start international civil aviation in the normal pre-COVID way, your domestic civil aviation must reach a certain threshold, 50% plus, because international flights will come into Mumbai, Kolkata, Bangalore. Now, if the international passenger comes here and there's no domestic, so we are very close to meeting that domestic 50% requirement. That used to be one of mine. But other countries must ease their visa restriction. Now, in the absence of that, we've done what I call the second best. We've opened up bilateral civil aviation agreements with large number of countries. United States, Canada, Britain, France, Germany, UAE, some other countries in the Gulf. I've added another 13 countries, including the countries in our neighborhood. What happens here? Here, the designated carriers of the two countries, part of this agreement or the bubble, they conduct a number of flights every once a day or many times a day or week under regulated conditions. What are those regulated conditions? That we have, for instance, opened up business visas to this thing. They are not open to just everybody. So they are open to Indians.
Is this the best solution that you could have offered, or are you looking at some kind of relief for this civil aviation
sector? I think it's a pretty good solution, because what has happened is, if 15 lakh people have availed of it coming back, and now I just read a report this morning, one of the American carriers, which was earlier flying daily between Delhi and Newark, is now Mumbai and San Francisco. Now they're multiplying the number of flights. So in other words, this is a transitional phase between total lockdown and normal civil aviation. Once visa restrictions open up, once quarantine restrictions open up, now before a traveler decides to embark on a journey, they check what is the quarantine restriction at the point of entry.
Right.
Does my existing visa work? For instance, a lot of people who had Indian visas, as a result of an MHA guideline, we had to issue instructions, look, certain categories of visas are, no, we were allowing diplomats, we were allowing business, but we are slowly opening up. As I said, we started with a very modest sum of something like 12,000 people in the first Vande Bharat phase, which was 6th May to 13th May. Today we are in phase 6, and I mean, frankly, I can't even monitor it. They're expanding so quickly. Whoever has got
it. One question that is being repeatedly asked, and I'm going to ask again to you today, sir. Has the pandemic scuppered the disinvestment of Air India?
Not at all. I could make out a very convincing case that the pandemic actually will act as a boost for the Air India investment. Let me explain to you why. Air India is one carrier which is not encumbered. It is not inhibited by the fact it has hundreds of planes on order, number one. Number two, we have been able to bring operating costs of Air India down by 1,500 crores a year. I have personally been involved in that exercise. Air India has a first-rate safety, engineering, cabin crew. It has a very good safety record. And what is more important, it has civil aviation access. It flies to 40-50 international destinations. It has 40-50-60 domestic destinations. It has 125 planes. All right, there are lessee arrangements and other things which need to be sorted out. So, normally, and this is a very interesting point I am going to make openly. One of my students, who is now an opposition politician, used to say about a neighboring country, they have an army which has a country attached to it. Actually, whoever buys Air India has a civil aviation market which comes with it.
Okay, tell me, since you have been talking about Vande Bharat missions, and now we are looking at the sixth phase which has started, the prices are very high. Delhi, Toronto ticket 1.7 lakh, Delhi, Houston 1.3. Are you looking at rationalization?
When Vande Bharat started, the highest fare was 1 lakh.
Hmm.
1 lakh. When the corresponding carriers of the other countries were charging 3 lakhs. It was never 1.3, it was 1 lakh and publicized. There may be an exchange rate issue, I don't know. But today, the fares are 50,000, 55,000, 70,000. They are competitive market fares. So this issue was, when you were flying very few aircraft had to be grounded there for 48 hours before it would get a journey back. That was for a short phase. And they were still the most competitive if you compared them to fares charged by
others. Okay, now coming to the questions related to your other ministry, Metro in particular. Metro lines across Delhi, Noida, Lucknow, Kochi, Bengaluru, Kolkata, Chennai, Hyderabad have resumed services, but in a calibrated manner. There is also a view that because the cases are rising, have you rushed into opening these?
Not at all. I think, look, mobility, urban mobility is the lifeline of an economy. If you don't run a metro system or you don't run a public transport system, doesn't mean people will not travel unless they're in quarantine. They need to travel. So what will happen? They will go by cars, they will go by buses, they will drive by other means. Metro, like air transport, is one of the safer means of transport. But we have to be careful. Careful in the sense, let me give you the numbers. When we opened up on the 7th, we carried something like 15,800. I was speaking to, I'm talking about Delhi now, DMRC. Mangu Singh, I keep talking to him twice a day. Today, the figure I had this morning of yesterday was 198,000 journeys. I think till we reach the 10 lakh figure, and I think we'll reach the 10 lakh figure by, this is the opening which has been calibrated between the 7th and the 12th. So after the 12th, for a week or so, we'll have to monitor. The air conditioning system, the ventilation system inside a metro is so organized that it can take in heavy rush, which is what used to be there, crowding
right.
inside it. So that is not going to take place. We're not going to be able to countenance that kind of thing. Once the traffic reaches 10 lakhs, we will have to do some evaluation.
And when do you foresee that?
One week after tomorrow.
But Mr. Puri, are you also getting the sense that there are several states where they spike in cases? For example, even in Delhi, what is being seen as the second wave is happening? Again, Maharashtra
hasn't started. They haven't started the system yet.
So in Tamil Nadu, Chennai, because you have started. So I'm asking, are you looking at opening up more, or will there be a rethink based on the cases, the COVID cases?
Let me put it this way. The center provides overall guidelines. Each state is fully autonomous, capable of their own decision making. When we announced the opening from the 7, one of the states, Maharashtra, decided that they wanted a little more time. Fine. Maharashtra did the same thing with air traffic. Prior to COVID, Maharashtra used to have 1,000 flights a day. When we opened up post-COVID, they started with 25 arrivals, 25 departures. Then they raised it to 50 arrivals, 50 departures. Just now they're at 100 arrivals, 100. Let them calibrate their own pace. My own assessment is that states which have difficulties, now I'm not in a position to subscribe to what they're doing, but I don't agree with some of it. For instance, West Bengal doesn't take flights on 3 days now, okay, from certain cities, okay, or no flights at all for a few days, I think the evidence now is that you need to open economic activity by ensuring that precautions are in place, and therefore I see this opening taking place, and it will take place again, and it will evolve in a calibrated manner. As I said, in Delhi, I'm hoping that when we get 10 lakh passengers a day, yesterday was 10 lakh riderships a day, yesterday it was just below 2 lakhs, the latest figure I have. I don't see us in Delhi certainly, and Delhi accounts for about less than 400 kilometers of the overall 700 kilometers framework. I don't see us going back to pre-COVID levels of 6 million passengers in a day, 60 lakh in a day. That will not happen for the moment, because from our side and from the side of the passenger, they will take a little more time. We will see this increase. When we come at 10 to 10 lakhs, we'll have to see. Just now we are maintaining the same peak hour frequency for trains.
Sir, let me ask you the last question now, because reports are coming in that masks are off. People are moving around in trains without the mask. This safety protocol puts a lot of emphasis on individuals, self-discipline. When the footfall increases, don't you think this opening up of metro will, with that kind of behavior of individuals, defeats that purpose?
First of all, even when we did the first press conference, I said, we will have no hesitation in naming and shaming. There are cameras all over the place. If somebody is not wearing a mask, they will be pointed out or they will be seen. So all those safety precautions are in place. Look, the good news is that today people are wearing masks and people are maintaining social distance. What would happen if they don't? Well, I'm very clear in my mind. We might have to press a pause button. Because today, public opinion is a powerful instrument, but more than public opinion, I think there is a general heightened level of health consciousness which wants to emphasize the need for precaution. And so, therefore, the underlying sentiment when we opened up the traffic was that, look, we are opening up, but it has to be anchored in caution, and if those preventive measures are missing, the SOPs are not followed, we will have to strike a pause button.
All right. Thank you so much for speaking to us, and thank you for taking all the questions. Hardeep Puri, Civil Aviation and Urban Development Minister, speaking to CNN News 18.